Welcome, everyone. Today I want to talk about Vincent van Gogh, or Van Gogh. Van Gogh was a post-impressionist painter whose work, notable for its beauty and emotion and color, highly influenced 20th century art. He struggled in life with mental illness, his work, finance, and he remained poor and virtually unknown throughout his entire life. Van Gogh died in France in 1890 at the age of 37 from a self-inflicted gunshot wound. And this is just a portion of that story. On March 30th, 1853, Theodorus van Gogh, a country minister, and Anna Corbentus, an artist, welcomed their son, Vincent Wilhelm van Gogh, to their home in the Netherlands. Van Gogh was born exactly 1 year after his parents' first son, also named Vincent, was born stillborn. At a young age, he recognized that his name and birth date had already been etched on his dead brother's headstone. At the age of 15, Van Gogh's family was struggling financially, and he was forced to leave school and go to work. He got a job at his uncle Cornelius's art dealership, a firm of art dealers in The Hague, the Dutch city of Parliament. By this time, Van Gogh was fluent in French and German, English, as well as his native Dutch. In June of 1873, Van Gogh was transferred to the Grupel Gallery in London. He enjoyed England and visited art galleries in his spare time. He also became a fan of the writings of Charles Dickens and George Eliot. At this time, he also fell in love with his landlady's daughter. When she rejected his marriage proposal, Van Gogh suffered a breakdown. He threw away all his books except for the Bible and devoted his life to God. He was fired from his job soon after telling his customers not to buy the worthless art. Van Gogh then taught in a Methodist boys' school, and he also preached to the congregation. Although he was raised in a religious family, it wasn't until that time that he seriously began to consider devoting his life to the church. Now hoping to become a minister, he prepared to take the entrance exam to the School of Theology in Amsterdam. After a year of hard studying, he was kicked out. He had refused to take the Latin exams, calling Latin a dead language, not winning any friends in the meantime. Similar stubborn obstacles waited for him at the Church of Belgium. In the winter of 1878, Vincent volunteered to move to an impoverished coal mine in the south of Belgium. It was a place where preachers usually were sent as punishment. He preached and ministered to the sick, and spent time also drawing pictures of them, the miners and their families. They called him the Christ of the coal mines. The evangelical committees were not as pleased. They disagreed with Van Gogh's lifestyle, which they thought it had begun to take on a tone of martyrdom. They thought that he took the Christian message of charity too literally, and his his superiors were unimpressed with a preacher who dressed in rags and gave away all his possessions. They felt he was growing too involved in his congregation's lives, giving him money, food, clothing, places to sleep. Once his contract ended, they refused to renew it, and he was forced to find another occupation. He wandered during this time, not knowing where his path led, and in the fall of 1880, he had been sick and out of work for some time. He finally took the advice of his younger brother and decided to move to Brussels and pursue a career as an artist. He didn't have any formal training at this time, but his younger brother, Theo, who worked as an art dealer, recognized his natural-born talent and offered to support him financially. He began taking lessons on his own, studying books and copying masters. He began by transferring his works and relationships with the poor from preaching at them to studying and drawing them. This whole time, Vincent and his brother Theo kept in constant communication through intricately intimate letters. Vincent often wrote about his concern for the human condition and his art. Vincent was an extraordinarily passionate person, and it shows in these letters. The two brothers maintained an intensive correspondence, and Theo often encouraging his depressed brother. Theo was one of the few people who Vincent could talk to and confide in without hesitation. These letters that go on for years, and there are hundreds of them, they've provided historians many of the detailed accounts of not only the occurrences, but also the thoughts and feelings in Vincent's life. The letters have been collected and published in a book called The Letters of Vincent Van Gogh. I highly recommend checking it out. Although only Theo's letters remain, as Van Gogh being nomadic didn't save most of the letters that he received from his brother. Van Gogh had a troubled love life. He was attracted to women who were in trouble, the women that he thought that he could help. One of these women was Kate, his cousin, who was recently widowed. And when Van Gogh fell in love with her, she was so repulsed by him that she picked up and moved away. He then, in 1881, moved back to The Hague. There, he moved in with a homeless, alcoholic prostitute named Sien. She's actually portrayed in his canvas called Sorrow. Through his letters to Theo, he explained that although he loved her and he felt the need to help her, he felt a Christian duty to stay with her. That he recognized their relationship was affecting his ability to work, so he had to leave. While working with landscape artists in 1883, he finally began using oil paints. Girl in the Forest is one of his earliest paintings using his brush. He had left The Hague shortly after he met a woman who actually fell in love with him. This time, Vincent was the one that rejected her. It led to her attempting suicide and put him in another depression from yet another unhealthy relationship. This is when he became focused. Art was now everything to Van Gogh. His art helped him stay emotionally balanced and gave him purpose. A couple years later, in 1885, he began work on what's considered one of his first masterpieces. Maintain the familiar subjects of lower class struggling farmers and remain consistent with his melancholy dark colors. After its completion, Van Gogh became enamored with the French romantic work of Eugene Delacroix. Delacroix's strong use of color changed Van Gogh's palette from then on, forcing him to experiment more with color theory. In 1885, you'll see a pop of color, reds, yellows, greens, matchings of which are not normal for the post-impressionists at the time. In the spring of 1886, against the advice of Theo, Vincent showed up at his brother's home in Paris, in Montmartre. Men moved into his small house. Although he moved to Paris specifically for formal training, it did not agree with him, and he soon decided finding his own inspiration would be more beneficial. Through some of Theo's connections, he met many of the now famous artists of the time. He began studying with Henri de Toulouse-Lautrec, Pissarro, and Seurat. And around this time, we see a lot of Seurat and Pissarro's influence, the pointillism influence in his Paris pieces. If you look at any of his paintings, from around 1886, you'll start to see the dots, the pointillism dots, many of which show up in the background, but also are the focal points for some of his pieces. To save money, he and his friends posed for one another instead of hiring models. Passionate and abrasive, and he argued with other painters about their works, and he alienated those who became tired of his bickering. At this time, a lot of them turned their back on him. Van Gogh had become influenced by Japanese art, and he began studying Eastern philosophy to enhance his art and his life. He dreamed of traveling there, but was actually told by Toulouse-Lautrec that the light in a village in the south of France, the village of Arles, was just like the light in Japan. So in February of 1888, Van Gogh boarded a train to Provence in the south of France. And he moved into the little yellow house. And he spent his money on paint rather than food. He would work 16-hour days, running on coffee and bread and this time, his art became confident. And it's appropriate that he lived in this yellow house, as yellow was the primary color for him at this point. The letters written to Theo asking for supplies, yellow was always at the top of that list. He told his brother about his painting career, that he was simply trying to chase the sun and catch the light. During this time, Van Gogh began showing signs of mental strain. Although he was focused on enhancing his life through Eastern philosophy, his mind and his body withered. Theo became worried. Through their correspondence, he understood that his brother was having problems, and he offered Vincent's friend, Paul Gauguin, money to go to the south of France and watch over Van Gogh. Van Gogh saw this as an opportunity to begin what he had always wanted to start, an artist colony. Flowing ideas and common goals. And within a month of arriving in Arles, Gauguin and Van Gogh were arguing constantly. One night, Gauguin walked out. Van Gogh followed him with a razor blade. Gauguin fled, collected his things, and moved out. Hours later, Van Gogh went to a local brothel. He paid for a prostitute named Rachel. He presented her with a piece of his ear. And he asked her to keep this object carefully. The police found him in his room the next morning and admitted him to the hospital, or so the story goes. The doctors assured Theo that his brother would live and he'd be taken good care of. In January of 1889, Van Gogh was released from the hospital, but he was alone and depressed. For hope and purpose, he turned to painting and nature, but couldn't find peace, and he was hospitalized again. He would paint at the Yellow House during the day and return to the hospital at night. This didn't last long. After 80 of his neighbors in Arles signed a petition saying that Van Gogh was too dangerous, he decided to move to an asylum in Saint-Remy. On May 8th, 1889, he began painting in the hospital gardens. In November of 1889, he was invited to exhibit his paintings in Brussels. He sent 6 paintings, including the famous Star. End of January 1890, Theo and his wife Johanna gave birth to a boy and named him after Vincent. Around this time, Theo sold Van Gogh's first and only painting during his lifetime. It was the Red Vineyards, and it was sold for around 400 francs. 7 months later, July 27th, 1890, Van Gogh went out to paint in the morning as he usually did, but he carried a loaded pistol. It's thought that he shot himself in the chest, but the bullet didn't kill him. is found bleeding in his room. Van Gogh was taken to a nearby hospital and doctors sent for Theo. Theo arrived to find his brother sitting up in bed, smoking a pipe. They spent the next couple of days talking together. And then Van Gogh asked Theo to take him home. That night, July 29th, 1890, Vincent Van Gogh died in the arms of his brother. He was 37 years old. Theo, who was suffering from syphilis and weakened by his brother's death, died only 6 months later in a Dutch asylum. Theo's wife, Johanna, who was a dedicated supporter of Van Gogh's work, had Theo's body moved from its original plot to be buried at the cemetery next to Vincent. Johanna then collected as many of Van Gogh's paintings as she could, but she discovered that many of them had been destroyed or lost, or painted over. Van Gogh's own mother threw away crates full of his art. After collecting these pieces on March 17th, 1901, Van Gogh's paintings were displayed at a show in Paris, and his fame grew enormously. His mother lived long enough to see her son hailed as an artist and a genius. And today, Vincent Van Gogh is considered one of the greatest artists, the second greatest Dutch painter after Rembrandt, definitely one of the 20th century's most influential painters. He completed more than 2,100 works, 860 oil paintings, more than 1,300 watercolors, drawings, and sketches. Several of his paintings rank among the most expensive purchased in the world. His portrait of Dr. Gachet sold for almost $83 million. After more than 100 years since Van Gogh's death, more of his artwork was released. A painting of a landscape entitled Sunset at Mont. Van Gogh was known for his bold strokes, sweeping patterns. He painted with emotion and clearly laid it all out on the canvas for us to see. If you like that, like and subscribe, and stay tuned.